On this episode of Doing the Most, we're talking about how to bottle condition while also back sweetening.
Homemade brews and various ideas, everything from mead to roast, bake creation, fermentation, inebriation, doing the most.
Lately on the channel, we've been making a lot of hydromels, and hydromels are typically best enjoyed sweet and carbonated. And we've been using a kegging system for that, but I've heard from a lot of you who don't have kegging systems, and I'm not surprised. It's a huge investment for a home brewer. So I figured I would tackle the topic of bottle conditioning while also back sweetening, and I'm going to discuss two different ways. Some people say that the best way of doing this is to put your brew in swing tops, let those carbonate until they're about ready, and then put them in the fridge so the yeast cold crashes. I can tell you that this is effective if you are going to be drinking within the first few days, but that yeast still keeps going. And I've experienced this because I once left some ginger beer in the fridge, went out of the country on vacation, and when I came back, my fridge was full of glass and sticky liquid. It's not ideal. It's really not ideal. So typically, you would stabilize with potassium metabisulfite and potassium sorbate in tandem, and you're able to add fermentable sugars to back sweeten. That's a great way of adding honey back to a mead and ensuring it's not going to keep fermenting. The problem comes in when you want it to be sweet, but also sparkling. But say you bottle a mead or a cider with fermentable sugar in the bottle and yeast that hasn't been stabilized. That can create a bottle bomb, and it can be an explosive situation. I had one wake me up at 7 o'clock in the morning once, and it sounded like a gunshot went off in my kitchen. So the first way we'll discuss involves back sweetening to your preference and then bottling. And as soon as the appropriate amount of carbonation builds up, you pasteurize those bottles. But how do you know how much carbonation is in there? Well, the easiest way is to bottle one of your brews in a plastic bottle. Fill it all the way up to the neck, just like you typically would. But before you screw the lid on, squeeze all the air out, then put the lid on tight. Check this every few hours to a few days, depending on what temperature you're keeping it at. And when the bottle holds firm and you can't squeeze it anymore, you know now is the time to pasteurize your glass bottles. So what's a good way of pasteurizing your bottles? Well, the way I'd recommend is to get a Dutch oven and put a cloth in the bottom of it so it prevents your bottles from touching the bottom of the Dutch oven. Put all of your bottles in and then put in an uncapped bottle, even if it's just a bottle of water. Then fill that up with cold water. Then start slowly bringing that water up to temperature to about 165 degrees. Once the water in the pot reaches that temperature, use an instant read thermometer to start checking the temperature inside the uncapped bottle. Once the temperature in that bottle holds at 165 degrees for between 10 and 15 minutes, you know the rest of your bottles are properly pasteurized. Then take them out of the water, set them out to cool overnight, and then they're ready to go into your fridge. They should be perfectly bottle conditioned and ready to drink. Now, this method is okay, but it's a little outdated and kind of clunky, and it's hard to measure how much carbonation you're gonna get. When you're sweetening, you're just sweetening to taste, and you're hoping that the amount that ferments to turn into carbon dioxide is so little that it's not really gonna affect the flavor of what's in the bottle. But that's not an ideal situation. And of course, as always, there's a better way. The other way of doing this is by using a non-fermentable sweetener to back sweeten. I prefer erythritol. There's several different ones. There's lactose and maltodextrin, but they tend to provide more body and mouthfeel than they do sweetness. There's stevia, but in higher amounts, it kind of tastes like licorice and it has some astringency, so it's also not really ideal. Of course, there's Splenda, but everyone knows how artificial Splenda can taste, which is why I prefer sugar alcohols. Now, I used to recommend xylitol, but several folks pointed out that xylitol is fatal when consumed by pets. And since Sam the Wonder Dog is constantly running around licking everything, I didn't want to put her at danger of consuming xylitol. So I switched to erythritol. Erythritol is a sugar alcohol made from corn. And what they do is they use hydrolysis to convert cornstarch into glucose. And then they use fermentation to convert the glucose into the sugar alcohol erythritol. Erythritol doesn't seem to be dangerous to pets, and it doesn't really cause the gastrointestinal issues that some sugar alcohols can have on some folks. And that's because of the way it's basically passed through and out the body without a lot of processing. So erythritol is great, and it can be used in an almost 1-to-1 ratio as you would use sugar. I tend to find that it's more like 70% as sweet as sugar, so I always add a little bit more erythritol than I would sugar. This is a simple process, and we did it with this sweet potato cider that we made from sweet potato nectar. Let's take a look at how that works. Basically, you brew your cider, your mead, your wine, just like you always would, but you don't stabilize. You leave just a few yeast in suspension, even though it's probably cleared. Then you back sweeten with erythritol to taste. And the best way of doing this is to boil a little bit of water and make kind of a simple syrup with your erythritol. Just pour that in, stir gently, and keep adding until the taste is where you want it to be. And then you will prime with a fermentable sugar. And I recommend dextrose. Dextrose is what's used to prime beers and ciders all the time. And there are priming calculators out there that make it really easy. Basically, for most brews, you can be comfortable at using about 3/4 of an ounce per gallon to prime your batch. So that's what we did with the sweet potato cider. We added erythritol till it hit the sweetness that we liked, and then we put in 3/4 of an ounce of dextrose to prime. After 4 weeks, it is bottle conditioned, sparkling, has that nice hiss, and it also has a sweetness that helps back up those sweet potato flavors. Obviously, we did this with kind of a weird brew, but this would work for mead, cider, wines, even beers if you want to add some extra sweetness with non-fermentable sugars. So if you've looked at any of our recipes, like our boysenberry, blackberry hydromels, maybe the crispy hydromel, or several of the hydromels that are coming soon, they can all be back sweetened and carbonated just like this. I hope this video was helpful. I'd love to know what other topics you would like us to tackle on the channel. You can throw those ideas down in the comments. And of course, you can follow us on Instagram and Pinterest at Doing the Most Okay. If you'd like to support the channel, just become a YouTube member. It's $4.99 a month, and the link is down there in the description. And of course, it helps us out a lot because there's obviously a lot of expense involved in homebrewing and bringing this content to you. We really appreciate all of our YouTube members and our patrons. Until next time, happy brewing, stay safe, and cheers.